Welcome to Program 10 in Mission Possible. The mission we have is sustainable development of the Baltic Sea region. And let us start by reminding ourselves, what is actually sustainable development? Well, it is a development that meets the needs of the present generation, of us, without destroying the possibilities of future generations, our children and grandchildren, to meet their needs. So it is about the using wisely our resources to protect nature and to build an economically and socially good society. Today we will sum up what has happened during the previous 9 programs, and will we also look ahead. And the starting point is very naturally, for many of us, the big conference in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, the Earth Summit. At this meeting, they formulated an agenda for next century, an Agenda 21 that was adopted by all the present state. And this agenda was an agenda for global sustainable development. It was signed, I believe, by 181 states. And one of the persons who actually took part in negotiating this agenda was Bo Kjellén, who is with us here today. Bo, tell us something of what has happened since 5 years ago.
Well, Lars, you already mentioned Agenda 21. This is the document, quite a book, and negotiated all of it, all the 400 pages. So you all know about the real results. But what were the real effects of Rio? I think there were mainly 5. First, we understand better now that there are global threats, climate, ozone layer, etc. Second, that there is more strength now in environmental policies nationally and internationally. Third, that we have a new set of international agreements. Climate Change Convention is one of them. Fourth, that we got a breakthrough for the civil society, non-governmental organizations. And five, perhaps most important, the work at the local level has come forward. Now we are preparing for this summer in June a special session of the General Assembly to review results after Rio. We have noted that environmental degradation globally has continued, poverty is continuing, but that on the other hand, there is a lot of action now being taken at all levels, and that the international community is starting to take its responsibility. As far as New York is concerned, in June, we will try to accelerate ongoing negotiating processes. We will try also to start something new on certain sectors, which also for Sweden and for the Baltic countries are very important. Water, fresh water, forests, oceans and seas, including the Baltic, energy, transport, and also issues related to land degradation.
Madeleine Granvik, who is with us here, you took part in the follow-up activities immediately after the Rio.
Yeah, I think the Rio conference succeeded in putting the focus on the connection between the international level and the local level. And this concept, think global and act locally, has really become the key expression in the follow-up process. And this, I believe, is a main step in this. It's a requirement when developing the sustainable society to put a very, very focus on the local level and to involve ordinary people in this. That is the really challenge for today. And the fact that 181 states have signed some documents 5 years ago doesn't mean that it really happened things. So we have to translate the words into action. That's our mission.
And one region where a lot of things has happened is the Baltic Sea region, because it's an east-west cooperation that has been possible to develop after the changes some few years ago. Lars Kristoffersson has been very much involved in this cooperation between east and west.
Environment is one of the old topics in this Baltic Sea region cooperation. It started already more than 20 years ago, as you know, with the Helsinki Commission. The latest addition to this web of cooperation that is now spun over the Baltic Sea is something called Baltic Agenda 21, or Baltic 21. And it is, of course, a local version of the not the local, but the regional version of the Agenda 21, in between the global level and the local level, which Madeleine talked about. And as such, it's unique. There is no other place where the governments of a region have come together.
And this was decided very recently.
This was decided 1 year ago, and it is kind of a message and a question from the prime ministers of the 9 countries in the region, plus the European Union, who asked for this to be done. And it was started about half a year ago, or rather a quarter of a year ago, and involves not only the 9 countries around the Baltic Sea and the European Union, but also the international development banks, the business, the environmental movement, and the universities. So in that respect, it's quite a unique level of cooperation.
What are the topics that will be discussed in this plan for the Baltic Agenda 21?
Agenda 21, as you know, is not only about environment, it's more of even a social and maybe political process. But this has to be limited, and this is also to be regarded as a first step. And there are 7 sectors, the most important sectors from the point of view of economic development and the environment: agriculture, energy, industry, fisheries, forestry, tourism, and transports. Those sectors together will be the focus of the first stage of this.
And we will go through several of these different topics, and we'll start with energy by looking at a report from Denmark that focuses on the possibilities to come up with the alternative energy sources. It's bioenergy.
Was Milchkuh Hertha hier ausscheidet, ist letzten Endes wertvolle Energie. Denn Mist und Gülle sind weit mehr als ein Abfallprodukt. In ihnen steckt noch reichlich Energie, die genutzt werden kann. Das Stichwort lautet Gewinnung von Biogas. Mit Hilfe des Sonnenlichts bauen Pflanzen aus Wasser und Kohlendioxid energiereiche Stoffe auf. Tiere nutzen jedoch nur einen Teil davon und scheiden den Rest wieder aus. In Gärtanks wandeln Mikroorganismen das organische Abfallmaterial in ein Gasgemisch um, Biogas. Es besteht überwiegend aus Methan und kann durch Verbrennen zur Erzeugung von Strom und Wärme verwendet werden. Die beim Verbrennen frei werdende Menge Kohlendioxid wird von den Pflanzen wieder aufgenommen. Damit ist der Kohlendioxidkreislauf geschlossen. In dieser 1994 in Betrieb genommenen Anlage der Gemeinde Torso bei Aarhus in Dänemark werden täglich rund 280 Tonnen Biomasse angeliefert. Die angelieferte Biomasse wird in diesem großen Betonsammeltank gründlich durchmischt und zu einer gleichmäßigen Masse verarbeitet. Dann gelangt sie in einen der Gärtanks. Einige Wochen lang gärt hier die Biomasse bei rund 52 Grad Celsius. Dabei entstehen täglich 7500 Kubikmeter Biogas. Das entspricht 4500 Litern Heizöl. Torso ist eine Kleinstadt. Schon seit Jahren gibt es hier ein Wärmenetz, an das nahezu alle Haushalte angeschlossen sind. Im Blockheizkraftwerk wird das Gas in 2 Motoren verbrannt. Die dabei entstehende Wärme wird über Wärmetauscher in das Wärmenetz eingespeist. Außerdem werden 2 Generatoren mit einer elektrischen Leistung von je 600 Kilowatt angetrieben. Die Biogasanlage deckt so den Strombedarf von 2400 Haushalten ganzjährig ab. Die jährlich zusätzlich erzeugte Wärme entspricht mehr als 1,6 Millionen Litern Öl. Und dies ohne die Atmosphäre mit Kohlendioxid zu belasten. Die ausgefeulte Gülle, durch die Behandlung von Geruch und Ätzwirkung befreit, kann auch während der Wachstumsphase auf die Felder ausgebracht werden. Nitrathaltiger Kunstdünger wird überflüssig. Ein weiterer positiver Effekt der Energiegewinnung aus Biogas.
So the Baltic region is special in the sense that it's several of the countries are very dependent on fossil energy, which is different from this, of course. Lars, how do you see this? What are the big problems when it comes to energy sources here?
The big problems are different in the former socialist countries and on the other countries in the West. I think in the former socialist countries, the energy systems are characterized, but they are very polluting and also using old-fashioned technology. So it's a very rapid transition that is needed there to bring the energy system into some kind of sustainability. But also, both there and in the West, it is dominated by fossil fuels. Mm. The development of renewable energy, as we've seen, it takes place, but it is still slow, except, you may say, in Sweden and Finland, where forestry energy, wood energy, is rather much used. But otherwise, it takes too long time.
So you mentioned two reasons for turning into new sources of energy. One is that the old ones are polluting, and the other was they will simply end to exist. They are not sustainable. Bo, do you have a comment on this?
What's of course, in the long run, it's certainly not sustainable with fossil fuels. But already today, of course, we have the effects on global climate through the emissions of carbon dioxide. And there, this year, we have a very important meeting in Kyoto in December on the of the Convention to Combat Climate Change. And the European Union, for instance, has proposed that one should all the industrialized countries should agree to have a reduction of 15% up to year 2010 of their emissions of carbon dioxide, or greenhouse gases, as compared with 1990. Mm. Now, if we can achieve this, it will be a very important step, and should also, I think, make it possible for us and demonstrate that efforts like we saw on this movie here, new ideas and more imagination with regard to energy production are called for. Mm.
And is it only states who should take such initiatives? What do you say, Madeleine?
Yes, you're talking about the production, the producer side, but there's another side, the consumption side as well, of course, and how we as consumers can be a little bit more sustainable. First is about saving energy, of course, to be more aware of what we are doing in our daily life, heating our houses, going by transport, going by car or going by bicycle. We have a choice there. And another aspect is to use the energy more efficiently, of course.
We saw that the energy, of course, sector is one very unsustainable sector in the Baltic region, but also agriculture was discussed in this insert from Denmark. And the use of the sludge for as a nutrient source for the feeds is very unusual. In fact, there is a lot of artificial fertilizers used here, and also fossil energy for agriculture. So it's not at all sustainable. The question is how to develop agriculture in this sector. Lars, do you have an idea about this? What to do with agriculture in the Baltic Sea region?
I think agriculture is one of those sectors where there are big differences between the countries in the West and the countries with economies in transition because of for historical reasons. And being a big polluter, something definitely needs to be done. But I think it's important to realize that changes are needed in all countries, for slightly different reasons. There are great problems and something needs to be done, but the way ahead, I think, is not yet clearly defined.
Yeah. And again, there are several forces possible here. One is the interest from the consumer.
Yes, for example, in Sweden and in Denmark and Germany, the demand for ecological products are really increasing. You can see that the last 5 years it has really increasing rapidly. And for example, Sweden, we have to import ecological products from Holland. And that is not really sustainable because of the transportation. So it's very many aspects on this.
Of course, ecological products are, it's not so much now, but the idea is that the year 2000, there should be 10% of the farmers should be ecological farming. Another aspect of agriculture is biodiversity, because the way agriculture is being made has a great impact on biodiversity in the region. Again, when what is happening here in the region, do we see the Baltic Sea region as a biodiverse region or as one where biodiversity is diminishing? What do you say, Lars?
Again, here we have big differences between the different countries. But I think one of the more interesting features here is that biodiversity, in fact, is one of the greatest assets on the environmental side by in the countries in transition. And that, I think, has to be noted.
Yes, I think in fact that, as you know, there is an international convention also on biological diversity. It's based on national action programs. One discusses lots of things, including biosafety, for instance. But when you look at the Baltic region, exactly as Lars is saying, here we have very interesting areas where biodiversity is certainly a sort of reserve for the region and which has to be maintained. And I think this is particularly important since we can see now that there will be rapid economic growth in the region, tourism will be developed. It will be very important for us in the Baltic Sea region to maintain biological diversity, and this will not at all be easy, but if we start now, I think there are good chances of success.
Mm-hmm. So agriculture is one sector that pollutes, but the traditional sector that really is blamed for pollution is industry, of course, and it's true that there are quite some places where industry has been extremely polluting. So is this the right picture of industry in the Baltic region, would you say?
Well, it may be in some parts, but I think what we saw here, and I think that's important when you talk about industry and environment, was the kind of old-fashioned industry, the industry that uses a lot of natural resources, mining, steel, the heavy industry, the classical industry. And of course, we also know that we had great problems with them in Germany, in United States, in Pittsburgh, in Ruhrgebiet, wherever it was. But also that those problems could be overcome by investments, by modernizing, by investing in new technology, in cleaning up, and so on. And this is, of course, what is happening now in the countries in transition, that the old-fashioned industry is being cleaned up by investment financed through economic growth.
So, of course, it's very important that these countries use the correct technology, not what we did 30 or 40 or 50 years ago. Bo, do you have a comment on this?
Well, yes. One of the issues that we are now pushing in the international arena together with the European Union is what is called sometimes the factor 10, how you can reach more efficiency in the industry and, in principle, do more with less. And we believe that there are indeed great opportunities in this, and also commercial opportunities. So I would agree very much with what you say when you say that we have to plan for industry for the future and not go back to what we have already passed.
And perhaps it's important to stress that there is not necessarily conflict between economy and industry here and environmental improvement, because after all, environmental pollution is that the resources getting into the factory are destroyed and disappearing through the chimneys. So it's better to produce from the resources than to pollute. We will have a look at what's going on in Krakow, where the new regime has been extremely successful in changing the way their industry is working.
We entered into a very laborious and long studies and negotiations with the biggest polluters, like steel mill of Nowa Huta, where together with the management of the steel mill and also in coordination negotiation with the workers' unions, we started to devise or invent a restructuring program. This restructuring program, in fact, agreed with the management and with the workers' unions, resulted in a rapid decrease in environmental pollution from the steel mill. In fact, in the early 90s, the pollution dropped by two-thirds. And one of the reasons for that is, of course, that the market forces eliminated some types of facilities there, which means that some types of production which were regarded economic under the command and control system proved not to be economic in the market system. But also we helped to find government support to restructure certain processes like introduction of continuous casting, shutting down of open house furnaces, elimination of coke plants and other things without really stopping the production. However, the production was also agreed to be reduced by two-thirds. It's not 6 million or 6.5 million tons of steel now, but 2.3 million tons of steel. But the key thing is that many processes were eliminated and new energy effective and not polluting processes were introduced. So the attitude of local government but also of non-governmental organizations has changed. They did not demand anymore to shut down the plant, but they, so to say, helped to solve the problem. And because of that, and because of shutting down of one of chemical plants, Solvay, the industrial pollution stopped to be a real problem in Kraków. The problem that we still have is environmental problem from heating systems. Houses and homes are heated in Kraków basically still by coal-fired stoves, home stoves, very much polluting. And the new problem was created related to car traffic, which is now at the level of 300 cars per 1,000 inhabitants in Kraków. It's approaching the western level, but the road system is not adequate to that.
So the industrial sector is a sector where solutions to problems start to appear, but as you saw, we have a new sector coming in here, transportation and traffic, that's really a problematic one. It is a sector with many problems, with a lot of resource consumption, and we really do not have any very good solutions for that. Okay, so what can we do with traffic and transportation problems in the Baltic region?
I think we have to realize here, as in many other situations, that there are different priorities in the different countries, very much so, particularly in the short term. But in the long term, I think we all know, because of the climate threats and other things, that we have to make big changes together. But in the short term, priorities may be different. I think we also have to learn from the mistakes that we have done here in the West, in Sweden and in many other countries, by the inner cities with the bad fuels and with not developing the right technology in the right time.
So what would the priorities be?
Well, I think we have to realize that you can't stop automobilism as it is. It's something that is necessary, but we have to realize that in the longer term, 20, 25, 30 years, there has to be radical changes in our transport systems, not least in the cities. Spatial planning, city planning is important here. Man and woman should try to reconquer the cities from the automobile. And I think that at the same time, we won't go back. We need something that is sometimes called eco-mobility.
So there are some alternatives. There are technical solutions, there are lifestyle solutions, and perhaps also we could plan a little different, and as Bo Kjellén said. So let's look at these alternatives.
The private car has given a degree of control over time and space, and quantities of movement. Of course, changes to a better way of transport don't come overnight, but we all have to start to think about our use of cars so we don't end up to be forced to make radical changes in a very short time.
So, making all these changes happen is what Agenda 21 is all about. So let's have a look at how Agenda 21 is implemented in the Baltic region. And we'll start with a report on education, which is very basic in Agenda 21. And this is from a school in Gdansk in northern Poland.
Marcin z Mają będą pobierali te organizmy, które już nieraz badaliście. Natomiast nabierzecie wody do słoików, będziemy później badać tą wodę w szkole. Zanim zbadamy, Gosia papierkiem zbada pH, porówna ze skalą. Natomiast wasza trójeczka jeszcze pozbiera śmieci tutaj za płotem.
Teraz sprawdzamy pH wody.
No, odpytaj. Jedno i drugie jest to samo. Czyli ile?
5,5.
5,5. Porównaj drugą, bo zawsze dwie próbki porównawcze robimy.
pH wody jest 6,5.
pH wody jest 6,5, czyli kwasowość wody.
Tak.
Pamiętaj, obydwa wyniki sobie zapiszemy w szkole do naszych badań. Małych nie znaleźliście, nic z takich malutkich. Przed rokiem co najmniej były problemy. Ta okolica była również przez młodzież dewastowana. Więc doszliśmy do wniosku, że trzeba by się tym stawkiem zainteresować pozytywnie. Czyli tak zainteresować młodzież, żeby i ona traktowała ten teren bardzo jako swój.
Stawek jest to zbiornik retencyjny na Potoku Karlikowskim, który wpływa do Morza Bałtyckiego i on pełni funkcję oczyszczania tego potoku, ale zamartwiliśmy się tym, że on śmieci z tego stawku mogą zanieczyszczać nasze morze. I tak to się zaczęło.
Na początku co miesiąc chodziliśmy i badaliśmy, znaczy jaki jest stan czystości wody, tak jak dzisiaj łowiliśmy zwierzęta. No i stan był zły, bo miał trzecią klasę czystości, czyli najgorszą.
Ale przede wszystkim myśmy się najpierw nauczyli badać, jak to robić, bo przedtem nie umieliśmy tego robić. I razem z panią od biologii, ona właśnie jako pierwsza wpajała nam, jak to wszystko działa. Właśnie razem z nią rozpoczęliśmy te badania.
Łatwiej taką wiedzę zdobyć właśnie w praktyce, jak jesteśmy nad stawkiem, mamy okazję łowić te żyjątka, spostrzegać jakieś ich zachowanie, a w ławce nie byłoby to samo, bo książki nie oddają takiego całkowitego ich wyglądu. I dużo dzięki temu się nauczyliśmy, zaczęliśmy od 6 klasy i jesteśmy już w 8 klasie, za rok skończymy tą szkołę i myślę, że będziemy przychodzić jeszcze chociaż trochę badać, pomagać naszym młodszym kolegom.
Mnie się wydaje, że w tym momencie nie myślą o konkretnym przedmiocie, poznają przyrodę, kontaktują się ze środowiskiem
I to jest chyba to pozytywne. Niekoniecznie, żeby rozdzielać, że to jest geografia, chemia, biologia. Ja jako chemik też w tej chwili pełnię funkcję biologa, więc myślę, że akurat tutaj integracja przedmiotów i ekologia jest takim przedmiotem interdyscyplinarnym. Tak. I tutaj ten stawek najlepiej nam to pokazał.
Ten stawek przeszedł taką metamorfozę, że ja byłam bardzo z tego zadowolona, aż było przyjemnie patrzeć na to. Myślę, że też nauczyłam się, jak można coś, co jest naprawdę w złym stanie, zmienić na dobre. I tak jest wszędzie, tak jest na przykład nawet na ulicy, jak idę ulicą, przecież koło mnie, koło domu wszystko mogę zmienić. To jeśli wezmę się po prostu do pracy i na przykład, jeśli na przykład mój ogród jest na przykład nieuporządkowany, to mogę to wszystko zmienić. Nauczyłam się, jak to robić.
So there were 181 states that signed Agenda 21, and there are today about 2,100 municipalities that are involved in this process, and in about 60 countries. And all countries in the Baltic Sea region are involved somehow in this process. And for example, in Sweden, there are all municipalities, all 888 that are involved. And the implementation process looks, of course, very different because of the different conditions, both between the countries and between municipalities. And my experience is that the most municipalities focus their work on waste management and to spread information in the first phase. And the topics like energy and transportation, traffic, are more complex to deal with at the local level.
Well, I really think that all this is tremendously important, what is being done at the local level. And for us who negotiate internationally, it's really a great encouragement to know that there is so much done locally. And I always come back to this. This is the real basis for working on the Agenda 21 and changing the situation. And that's also why I think that the regional Baltic Agenda 21 is so important.
Mm-hmm. Actually, this school we saw here is not too bad, and the waste management is not so bad either, because it often starts with practical steps. Mm-hmm. If people get involved actively, practically, they really start thinking and changing attitudes, and they act differently, and they tell these kids tell their parents, so they make things change. I'm sure about this.
Learning so by doing.
Learning by doing is actually what we should learn to do, yes. Mm-hmm. And of course Gdansk is one municipality to change this, but it's going on in many places. And just as a sign that eastern states here are important is that there was a few weeks ago one conference in Belarus about implementing sustainable development in countries in transition, and we listened to two of the participants. First, Tönis Kasik, the former Minister of Environment in Estonia, and then Sergei Doroshko, who is an NGO university representative in Belarus, in Minsk.
Eesti astub viimasel paaril aastal konkreetseid samme muutmaks oma ühiskonda, senisest ühiskonna korraldus senisest säästlikumaks. Kuigi kümmekond aastat juba maailm tunneb selliseid mõisteid nagu säästev areng ja ka 21. sajandi päevakord või Agenda 21, siiski neid praktiliselt on ellu viidud väga vähestes kohtades. Nüüd Eesti on astunud paar väga konkreetset sammu. Üks on siis Eesti Vabariigi seadus säästvast arengust 95. aasta veebruarist, sellel järgnenud kõrgetasemelise valitsuskomisjoni moodustamine, mida juhib riigi peaminister, kuhu kuuluvad paljud valitsusliikmed ja tuntud isikud ja teadlased ja ka valitsusväliste organisatsioonide esindajad. Et ma loodan, et võib-olla see kombinatsioon suudab probleemi paigalt nihutada ühelt poolt. Teiselt poolt muidugi on alt vaja rahva survet ja rahva teadlikust. Poliitikud otsuseid muidu ei tee, kui neil ei ole valijate survet selja taga. Aga tundub, et see surve hakkab tekkima juba kohtadel, sest väga mitmed maakonnad, linnad ja vallad on deklareerinud, et nemad soovivad oma kohalike Agenda 21 ühtesid. Nad soovivad paika panna oma valla või linna arengu järgmise sajandi 20. 30. aastani. Ja need on juba esimesed surveelementid, ja loota on, et võib-olla ka poliitikud võtavad seda kuulda. Võib-olla ka 21. sajandi kavandamine nii riigi kui ka kohalikul tasandil muutub senisest prioriteetsemaks. Seda tähtsustatakse ka nii valitsuses kui parlamendis senisest enam.
І сьогодні під час міжнародної конференції, коли обмірковувалося питання об уділі громадськості для доступу до екологічної інформації, уділі громадськості у працівці рішень, зв'язаних з устойливим розвитком, шмат говорилося об тим, що різні коли громадськості повинні удільничати у гетим. Перш за все, це неурадовые организации, которые работают для выхода из экологического кризиса. Так само это университеты, так само это масс-медиа. Приводю еще приклад, что в Беларуси, когда шла выпрацовка национальной стратегии устойливого развития, про сродки массовой информации ничего не поведомлялось для громадскости. Это великий жаль, и я меркую, что при выпрацовке национальной стратегии, национального плана деяния, эта помылка будет выправлена. И я могу сказать, что под час закончения працы над национальной стратегией урешті-решт неурадовые организации были запрошены, и независимые эксперты, и ученые были запрошены. Але я меркую, что сила любой национальной стратегии, сила любой национальной политики будет больше мощной, когда у ее, у працовцы ее, будут удельничать как мага больше людей и больше мага специалистов. И тому я сподіваюся, что еще эту и стратегию, и национальный план деяния мы сможем полепшить, чтобы она была лепшей для нашей Беларуси.
So the fight for participation in Belarus, that everybody should get involved in this process, and of course that is one key message here. How to get people involved and how to let them get involved. But there are many other such messages. What is the one that you would like to send?
Well, I think that we have to realize that there is a problem, because that's not always easy to realize all that in the kind of all the thousands or millions of messages that we get every day and every second in modern society. There is a problem. There are certain things we must do something about. But we also have to realize that there are many solutions. There are things we can do, and very practical things we can do. Therefore, we have to learn from experience, and there is both good and bad experience that we have to learn from.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think really, Lars, that you point to something very important, and that is the role of education and information. I think that in a way education is central, because we will all have to reflect on our lifestyles and we will have to accept change, but you can't impose that. A government in a democratic country can't tell people to change lifestyles. That has to happen because we're all convinced that it has to be done, and therefore education in promoting the kind of individual responsibility that we can have, when we say we have a responsibility as a person for a future far beyond our own lifespan. And I think that's an essential message to give.
Mm-hmm, yes, I all agree what you have been said. And this to learn from each other, to learn from Western, to learn from Eastern side, and both from mistakes and from best practices. I think we have to really think about that perspective, to learn from each other.
Mm-hmm. Of course, it's also very important to say here that this is not the question of getting a worse life. It's not that we have to sacrifice something. It's rather that we have a chance to develop something. And of course, this is even more important in the former socialist countries, because there is such a change of their societies right now. So it's important to be aware of what are the possibilities when implementing all these changes.
Yes, I think this is such a challenging time. There are many risks for the future, including certainly the environment, but it's also a very thrilling and challenging time we're living through. And I think that as we approach a new millennium, this is really an important thing for us. It's an opportunity we have for a better life, perhaps different in various respects than what we have experienced so far, but certainly with great opportunities. Mm-hmm.
I think sustainable development is a vision. I think it, and it must be a vision. But we have to be very careful with visions, because many of us living around the Baltic Sea have been experiencing a quite different vision for about 70 years. It was a bad vision, and something that devastated the country, the countries, the environment, and everything else. But there are also good visions, and I think they have to be built on an open society. They have to be built on individual responsibility, on education, and so on. And I think that is what we need to develop sustainable development into a good vision of a good life.
So we have come to an end of our TIRI series, but this is just the beginning of our mission, the mission possible, the mission of a change for the Baltic region to a sustainable Baltic region. Thank you for being with us this series of programs, and good luck with your contribution to our sustainable Baltic region.
Which areas are the most problematic ones? Which are the main burning issues in the near future?
Always population, energy is vital to how we can cope with the changes and the challenges before us. Knowledge, how to avoid population growth, which is excessive. Knowledge, how to save energy, to have energy efficient production processes, is a vital link to the future. Now, the spreading of knowledge, the spreading of insight is also a democratic challenge. This is why I believe that education, the spreading of technology, knowledge about technology and new solutions is really a vital aspect.
And what do you think the ordinary man and woman can do? Can they do anything at all?
Well, as I say, democracy is basic. It's only by standing together that people can make changes in their society based on a democratic responsibility, because we are all responsible for ourselves and each other. So it means be active in your own society, look at what is necessary, argue for change, and use your democratic rights on behalf of your children. If that happens in many countries, we will see the necessary change.
On behalf of our grandchildren, are you an optimist?
Yes, I am.